couple of weeks ago, we took a look at the HP 85. One of the things we mentioned was our machine needed some repairs and we just completed the first one. Well, the foundation of any system is its power supply. Ours had packed up. Today, we're going to take a look at what broke and how it was repaired. The HP 85 is an industrial design work of art. To get inside, you'll want to pull any carts that you might have installed. Then you need to remove the tape drive eject button, just pull it straight out. And then the last step is to undo the 6 screws in the base. Et voila, we can lift the top away like a cloche at a Shishi eatery. The monitor and all the graphic circuitry is in this self-contained block on the left. The printer, tape drive, and power supply are this other self-contained unit on the right. Then the keyboard hinges up, and under it we have the main logic board. As you can see, that's pretty streamlined too. The three units are hooked together by flat flex cables. HP seems to have had a real thing about them in these late 70s designs. Documentation for this system is available, but what HP provided is very much targeted for an assembly level debugging approach. Thankfully, they still gave out some schematics. With all things HP, your research resource of choice has to be the fantastic, and I do mean bleeding fantastic, HPMuseum.net website. They have all the docs you could require. They even have contributed hand-drawn schematics for some systems where documentation was never published. These come as contributions from the remarkable Tony Duell. Link in the description, of course. When the HP 85 was released in 1980, the in-house journal did a whole issue covering the new machine. They were proud enough of the power supply itself to give it a specific write-up. This machine has no fan. That may be due in part to the lowish clock rate on the processor. Remember, this runs at 625 kHz, but it is definitely also due in part to a careful passive cooling design. The power supply design was completely custom. It was intended to deliver very high efficiency. It draws a nominal 25 watts with a maximum of about 40. To meet the then-new EMF radiation regulations, a custom transformer was spun and the whole interior of the case was metallized. Which is all great, right? But what we have here is a fundamental failure to power on. Time for the usual note of caution. Your host for today is an electronics idiot, but he's had a few facts drilled into him and I gotta pass them on to you now. This is a power supply, so there's some mains lecky in there, and it could actually kill you. Do not attempt any of this at home unless you understand the risks. Please take all appropriate precautions. For instance, it's a good idea not to work alone, and perhaps also use an isolation transformer, and even an RCD plug adapter is a good idea. First bit of diagnostics? It's not going to be the main fuse because we've got glowing LEDs. That means we've got some input. So we need to check the power supply's output voltages. One or more of them may not be working. Easiest place to test them without yanking everything to pieces is actually the connector between the power board and the main logic board, just here. There are two rows of pins. That top row of pins is connector J2. The bottom one is J1. J1 should show 12 volts on pins 17 and 16, the last two on the right. I get 12.2 there. As long as that's between 11.4 and 12.6, and it is, we're good. J2, pin 6, should be the 6-volt rail. I'm getting a couple of millivolts of noise and nothing else. It ought to read 5.7 to 6.3-ish. So that's problem number one. Over on pin 12, we should have the 5-volt rail, and that looks like, well, about 2 volts. Not good either. It should be between 475 and 525. J2 pin 8 should be the minus 12. I measure it at minus 11.5, so that's okay. Pin 4 should be minus 5, and it shows up as minus 4.8. That's in spec 2. The failing 5 and 6 volt rails supply power to logic and memory circuits. Without them, we're not going anywhere. Clearly, we need to have a closer look at the power supply board itself. We'll disconnect all the cables to the printer stroke power supply assembly. There are two flat flexes from the PSU to the processor board, and then there are two more from the tape drive on that same assembly. At the back, there's an AC input from the mains transformer. When I pulled that last connection, it was pretty evident that it was loose and nearly unseated. Not good. Last, and I always forget this, there's a ground strap at the back too. Next, let's extract the printer and power supply block. 4 screws to undo that from the case. It should, with some waggling, pull out cleanly. Behind it, you'll see there's the transformer, and you can also see the back of the mains fuse. Have a look at this whole assembly. The paper roll tray provides the structure everything bolts into. On one side, you have a stepper motor for the printhead. At the front, there's one for the paper advance. On the left, you have the power PCB. And at the front bottom, the tape drive is screwed on with its own separate logic board. We'll unmount the power board. Detach this flat flex at the top. That goes to the printhead. Then remove these motor drive cables at the bottom. Our starting point has to be checking the voltages at the various stages of the supply, beginning with the input. That means we have to plug the AC input from the transformer back in. I'm going to hang the board off the back of the machine where it should just about be able to reach if I set it on top of something. That allows us to get some instruments in close to it. Safety reminder, we don't have to touch the main side of the transformer, but remember where it is and keep clear. The secondary side still puts out a 30-odd volt punch, but it's less dangerous. Be warned and know what you're doing before you poke around. To start our diagnostics, in theory, we should have some load on the 5-volt supply. I'm going to carefully bung a resistor in there using the ribbon cable socket. That's a 15-ohm jobby for those playing along at home. Without it, I'm told via the forums that the 5-volt supply may float a little high. Not sure about that, but a little load won't hurt things. The power supply's rectifier puts out an unregulated 32 volts DC based on 26 volts of input AC. From that, it creates two separate regulated 12-volt buses and a minus 12. One 12-volt rail is dedicated for low noise load. The other can have noisy load. That low noise 12-volt bus gets tapped to create minus 5 volts and the 5 and 6-volt supplies. It's the 5 and 6 that aren't working. So let's do a health check on the inputs. The input from the transformer should be about 26 volts AC. In this case, I'm getting about 28 thanks to an overvoltage main supply. Domestic power supplies are surprisingly often overvoltage, but in any case, we have input. We'll move over to the input tap on transformer 2. That should give us the rectified supply at a peak 32 volts. Since we've not started regulating yet, I'm seeing a hot voltage here too, 36. That means we have basic rectification. So the key inputs feeding the 12 are okay. And the 12 is okay too, of course, we saw that during our initial output checks. So, somewhere east of the 12-volt supply, we're losing regulation. At this stage, instead of working outward from the inputs, we're going to walk back from the output, east to west on the broken power rails. On the schematic, starting from the 5-volt output, the first components you hit are this transistor, Q10, and this capacitor. The capacitor is a bit difficult to check in circuit, so we'll take the easier option. Let's see what Q10 is doing. The emitter output is 2.1 volt. Based on the earlier test, that's what we should have expected. It's what we get at the J1 connector. The collector is coming in on 6 volts, which is spot on for this schematic. And then the base input appears to be 2.8. And we can assume that's wrong, or we'd be getting 5 volts from the emitter. So we need to move further west and verify the next component. The circuit that emitter leg connects to is tapped for a reference voltage feedback loop. It's going into the inverted input of an op-amp in this DIP package, U4, so probably should have a look at that. It's marked with an HP part number, 1826-0139. A datasheet for this is, of course, impossible to find without a cross-reference. Turns out that this part is actually equivalent to an MC1458, in other words, it's a general-purpose dual op-amp. Here it is on the schematic. The first op-amp device we're interested in is B. We should probably check its input is correct. Pins 3 and 5 should give us the same thing. On pin 3, I'm getting 5.25, and that's close to the 5.1 on the schematic. But here's a mystery. On pin 5, the input we're specifically looking at, well, that's probing out a 0. They're on the same circuit. Just a sanity check, the voltage source for the circuit is VR4, a Zener diode. It shows 5.25 like pin 3. So is the input for op-amp B shorted? Well, the op-amp's inverting input is that 2.1 volts from the feedback. Okay, what's the output? Well, that comes out on pin 7. It connects to the base of Q12. It shows 3.8 volts. Personally, I'm an electronics ignoramus. I know just enough to be dangerous. Op-amps are still a bit of a mystery to me. I know the feedback input is wrong, and the direct input is wrong, and I'm going to assume the out is wrong too, but let's check the other device. The A device does show 5.25 on the direct input, and that's pin 3. On pin 2, the inverting input, it's showing nothing at all. There also doesn't appear to be anything coming out of it. This is supposed to be the 6-volt rail feedback reference. So that's going to be wrong too. Either the trannies in these feedback circuits are misbehaving, or this op-amp chip has issues. That pin 5 in the first device appears to be being pulled to ground, so I'm going to place my bet on a dead op-amp chip. I ordered up a generic replacement. When it finally showed up, I did the part swap. Then I did it again because I had completely missed the fact that I hadn't seated the chip properly the first time I'd soldered it in. Here's hoping I haven't utterly cacked it. We'll run around the pins again. But before we do, I've built up a little model to try and help us understand what we should be seeing. This is a SPICE simulation. I fit in the subcircuit input characteristics. On the A side inverting input, pin 2, is 5.4. Direct input is also 5.4. Those voltages are hot. They should be around 5.1. The output is bang on 7 volts, and that's just what the model predicted. On the B side, we have the direct input matched between the op amps. It wasn't before. So it's now 5.4, just like on the A device, and 5.4 on the inverted input too. The model predicts a 6.3 volt output. In fact, the output is 5.4. I'm not smart enough to know the significance of that. However, it's clear that we have some regulation where we had none before. We'll just verify that with a whiz around the test points. On the voltage test points, I get 12.1 volts on the 12-volt test point, 5.4 volts on the 5-volt test point, 6.4 volts on the 6-volt, minus 4.4 on the minus 5. Well, those readings are still out of range, but clearly there's now something happening. To the best of my knowledge, the next thing to replace is that Zener. When I play with the model and make the input from the Zener, the 5.1, rather than the 5.4, everything else quiets down too. And that's what you'd expect for a voltage reference, isn't it? So, I salvaged a Zener from the spares machine. I removed and replaced ZR4, so another test. This time I'm probing on the back of the flex connector. On J1, pins 16 and 17, we get 12.1. Okay, well, same old, same old. Down on pin 12 is where we should be getting a 5-volt output. And we're getting 5.1. That's back in the safety zone. And on pin 9, we should have that 6 volts. It's coming out as 6.2, but drifts down to 6.1 as I probe. Finally, we'll check the minus 5 volt on J2. That's on pin 4. We've got a flat 5 volts there. Good. Of course, as it's all cabled up at this point, we should have been pretty optimistic. You see, it's actually booted. So, hurrah! We have logic. But there's a catch. The machine is complaining its print controller is defective. We have two of these systems. I've tried the controllers from both of them. No joy.
So we have more work to do. Not surprising, really. This machine used to be a flawless runner. But since it failed, it appears to have failed big time. We'll keep picking at this knot in more videos. Hopefully we won't need as many as Curious Mark needed, but time will tell. For today, we'll declare victory. Well, thanks for joining us. And if you like this video, please take a second to give it a thumbs up. And we'll keep making content like this, all about vintage computing and technology. So subscribe and hit that bell icon for notifications for new videos popping up in the future. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.